Hola Farmsteaders!
Hola!
We are Mac
and Jose,
and we are the Youper Farmstead.
Yes, yes.
Today Jose and I are going to talk to you about the six things you need to consider when doing your garden planning, which I'm finding to be much more complicated than I thought it would be originally. There are a lot of things to think about when planning your garden.
Yes.
Now, Jose, I feel like you and I have become very acquainted with this table over the last couple of weeks. Mm-hmm. We have been doing a lot of planning. And the reason for that is we want this to be as easy and automated as possible. But I feel like we still have a couple of weeks of planning left to do. We have to finish the garden plan.
Yep.
Then we have to do our seed order.
Mm-hmm.
Then we have to figure out how we're going to market all of this.
Mm-hmm.
And we haven't even started to consider the animals that we want to do on the farm. And we haven't thought about the orchard, because I know we want to get a minimum of 25 trees in the ground this year and get our orchard started. Because an orchard is a long-term plan.
Yeah, maybe 5 years.
Yes. So if we wait till next year, we're out another year.
Yeah.
So we really need to be thinking about all of those things. So I just feel like you and I are not desk people. We are get out, get our hands dirty kind
of
people.
We are action people.
We like to be doing and not sitting at a table. And while I know this needs to be done,
this is necessary.
It is very necessary.
Yeah. Today we have to talk about garden plan.
Yes. The garden plan is one of the most complicated things I've been doing so far on the garden. There are a lot of things to consider and think about.
Mac, what is the garden plan?
Well, a garden plan, Jose, is really what you're going to plant in your garden, when you're going to plant it, and where you're going to plant it.
Wow.
So there are a lot of things to consider so that you can automate this as much as possible. Because if you're transplanting, you need to know when to start those transplants
mm-hmm.
in your greenhouse. If you're gonna be direct seeding, you need to know which days you're gonna direct seed on. If you're gonna be succession planning, you need to be thinking about when you're gonna plant your first succession of crops and when you're gonna put the second succession in the ground. So you need a break already?
Wow.
There is a lot to think about. So in this video, we're covering the six things that in this first year I'm learning you need to consider when you're doing your garden plan. Are you ready, Jose?
I'm ready.
You're ready. You've had your coffee. All right.
What is the number one thing?
The first thing to think about when doing your garden plan is, what size is your garden?
Okay.
How much space do you have to plant in? Because space is really going to tell you a lot about how much you're able to plant.
Mm-hmm.
So for us, we've got a fairly large space.
Oh yeah.
Jose and I are doing a standard market garden bed, which those are 30 inches wide by 100 feet long. We have 22 of them ready to go for spring, but we know we want to probably do a few more than that. So we're going to be doing some work in the spring to prep some extra beds.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to have a lot of space. But because we want to know exactly what's happening in each bed during each part of the season, we need to have each of those beds earmarked with a certain crop.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what this garden plan is going to do.
So this is the first thing.
That's the first thing, Jose.
What is the next one, number two?
The next thing is to understand which planting zone you are in.
Okay.
Because every area of the country has different times of year when there's frost and when there's snow, and then obviously when you can be growing.
Yeah.
So you need to understand what your zone is.
Where you find your zone?
You can find there are zip code zone finders on the internet. We'll put a link to one down below because we want you to be able to figure out where your zone is.
Mm-hmm.
For us,
mm-hmm.
Jose, we are a zone 4B/5A. We're kind of right in the middle of zone 4 and zone 5. For us, our last frost date in the spring is May 28th.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, that's just the average day. A lot of times up here in Michigan, we get frost after May 28th. And our first frost date in the fall is generally on September 29th. Mm-hmm. That gives us about 120 growing days in the frost-free growing days in the season. So it's really important to understand this for your garden plan, because you need to know when you can put things in the garden and when you can't.
Yep.
Yeah, because that will definitely impact whether or not you have a successful year.
You don't want to lose your crops.
No, you don't want to lose your crops. You want to be as effective as possible. So it's important that you understand those dates. So the number two thing is to know your growing zone.
Okay, what is the next?
The third thing, Jose, is to know whether or not you're going to have access to a greenhouse or caterpillar tunnels, because these items are specifically designed to help you extend your growing season. So now that you know your growing zone, you need to know whether or not you're going to be using caterpillar tunnels and a greenhouse to extend those frost-free days for yourself. And we know we are going to be using a greenhouse, and our greenhouse will be heated, because we want to start, for example, our tomatoes and our peppers in the greenhouse at the very end of March, beginning of April, so that they have a couple of months to get growing before we put them out and plant them. So we do have access to a greenhouse, and we have two caterpillar tunnels, which will help us to extend our growing season for our cool season crops, like our lettuce mixes and our radishes and those kind of things. We'll be able to start even earlier than we would be able to if we didn't have access to those.
Good.
Yep, so that's number three.
What is the fourth thing?
The fourth thing is to be aware of when you want your crops to be available at the farmer's market or for your CSA shares, because then you can do a backwards plan. So if you know you want to have broccoli available or cucumbers available by this time in the year, you can look and say, okay, well, I need to put those in the ground 2 months before that, or 8 weeks before that, whatever the amount of time those crops need to be growing. So it's important to understand when you want to have your crops available, because if you just randomly put stuff in the ground and, you know, you might have a bunch of things being ready to be harvested all at once and have nothing for the week before that or nothing for the week after that. So really be aware of what it is and when you want to be bringing things to market.
Okay, let's go to number five thing.
Number five is, how long are your crops going to be in the ground? By understanding how long each crop is going to be in the ground, you're going to know whether or not you can do succession planting. Can you plant something in the ground before that? Will you be planting something in the ground after that? Because part of doing a market garden is to be as efficient as possible and to really be utilizing the space you have available. So for example, your tomatoes, you know, once you put them in the ground at the end of May or beginning of June, they're going to be in the garden the rest of the season. You won't be planting anything else in that bed, or with your peppers. Some things though, like lettuce and your lettuce mixes, are very short term in a garden bed, maybe as little as 35 days.
Wow.
So you're going to plant them and they're ready to harvest within 21 days.
Super fast.
Yes. So you'll be able to utilize that garden bed again after that crop comes out of the ground. So once you harvest it maybe two or three times, you'll reset that bed and plant something else. But that's important to know, because you don't want your beds just sitting when you could be growing in them. Because then you may be thinking you need extra space and you don't really. You can use the space you have available.
What is the last thing?
The last thing is to know how many plantings you're going to do of each item and where you're going to plant that. So for example, your tomatoes are probably going to go in the ground once and you won't have to think about planting another bed. But for things such as your lettuce mixes, you're going to be doing multiple plantings, because you want to have lettuce mix available, let's say, at every single farmer's market. You're going to be wanting to plant those every 2 weeks, probably. You're going to need to know, where in the garden are you going to be putting those plantings? Because you need to have the space available for each of those different plantings. So when you're doing your garden bed plan, you will be putting in that this garden will be allocated for lettuce for this month and a half, this bed this month and a half, and then if you can plant something before or after those crops, you're going to want to know. So it's important to know if you need to do multiple plantings of certain crops.
Wow.
Yeah. That's a lot.
Yeah.
Okay, so those are the six things you want to consider, especially in your first year as you're doing your garden plan. Mm-hmm. Because if you're not thinking about these things, you may be missing opportunities to have crops available at your farmers markets or for your CSA.
Yeah.
But there are two other things I think you could consider. Now, in your first year, you don't need to go crazy with these, but you might want to consider what you're planting next in beds next to each other, because if you're using row covers or insect nettings, you may be able to share those between crops.
Oh.
Instead of having to have just one row with an insect netting, you might be able to do two or three rows, help you save time putting those up. The other thing is how are you going to rotate your crops? Now, in the first year or two, this may not be that big of a deal. It's probably more important than you're getting your crops in the ground than where you're planting them. But as you get more effective and more efficient and into your further years and you've been growing a lot, you really want to rotate your crops so that you're growing different things in different beds every year to help eliminate the insect pest problems that you're going to have with each crop. So those are just two additional things that you could probably start thinking about, but won't be a huge concern in your first couple of years. All right, Jose, those are the six things that you need to consider when putting together your garden plan. So let's just go over them really quick one more time.
Okay.
Okay. Number one is, how much space do you have available in your garden?
Okay.
The second thing is, which gardening zone are you in? So you know how early you can start your crops and how late they'll probably be in the ground for that season. Number three is, are you going to have access to your greenhouses or caterpillar tunnels? So you know whether or not you can extend your season out. Number four is to do some backwards planning by knowing when you want to have crops available at the farmer's market or for your CSAs. Number five is, how long are those crops going to be in the ground for? And the sixth thing to know is how many plantings you're going to need to do of each of the different crops and where you're going to put those in your garden bed.
Good.
Mind blown. Yes, Jose? Like, so many things to think about. Take another break. Can I have some coffee?
Thank you. Hey, not that much.
Gotta love coffee. Well, thank you for joining us today. Jose and I are market gardeners up here in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. So if you are into farmsteading or homesteading, self-sufficiency, or you just love the Upper Peninsula, we hope that you will subscribe to our channel. Again, we are Mac
and Jose,
and we are the Upper Farmsteaders.
Thank you for watching.